say a particular word of welcome, whether at home, online, or with us in person. We are grateful that you are worshiping with us today and want to share with you. We are back from another amazing week at Montreat Youth Conference. When you see one of them, be sure to ask about their experience. It's an inspiring to hear what they have learned and what they saw and to see how they inspire us when they come off that mountaintop experience. Speaking of inspiration, during July, the Avondale ACE for Ed, our Alliance for Education, is collecting donations for the week-long overnight camp enjoyed by about 40 youth enrolled in the ACE for Ed summer program. Please drop off any of your donations at the church office by this Wednesday, July 31st. If you would like to contribute to the supplies needed, please scan the QR code that's on the screen. And then one pastoral note, we wanted to make sure that everyone knew that Fran McCoy's Celebration of Life service is scheduled for August 13th at 11 o'clock. That's Tuesday, August 13th at 11 o'clock. Also today, we will be collecting our 10 cents a meal, which goes to help for the hungry and the homeless here in Charlotte through Loaves and Fishes. Those are all of the announcements that we have for today. So let's come together for the reason that we've gathered, and that's to worship our Lord. I'm before you. O Lord, our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Hallowed be your heavens, the work of your fingers. What are mortals that you care for them?
Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor.
Lord, our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Let us worship our God. I invite you to join me in rising in body or in spirit as we sing our opening song, How Great is Our God.
We rose and shone.
So we turn to God as we join our voices and confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Please join me as we offer the prayer of confession that you find before you, but then take a moment for your own silence, your own personal prayers before a gracious and a loving God. Let us pray. O merciful God, hear our confession, we pray. We claim to be faithful, but we do not obey your commandments. We boast of our hope, yet we live in fear. We gather security about us while others go hungry. We arm ourselves mightily as though we could buy peace of mind. We hear Christ's words of assurance, but we do not live in his promise. Forgive our ambivalence and forgive us our complacency, we humbly pray. My friends, hear and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. So now let us extend that peace to one another, sharing. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us extend the peace to one another. Good morning. If we'd like to invite any of our young folks to come on up. Good. Hello, hello, hello. I am glad to see everybody today. Thank you for coming up, and thank you for helping me to learn a little bit more about God. I have a question for you. Have you ever been hungry? Raise your hand if you've ever been hungry. Have you ever been hungry? Ever? Oh, you know, I get... Yeah.
That's right. I get grumpy. I cross my arms like this, and I furrow my brow, and I scrunch up my face, and I stomp my feet around. You got to stomp your feet, because that really emphasizes how grumpy you are. And I go around, and I'm just going, show me your grumpy face. Do you have a grumpy face? Show me. Oh, that's good. Oh, yeah, oh, that's a good one. You got to scrunch up. And be sure to stomp the feet. That's really important. And then, you know, I'll eat an apple, or I'll have a sandwich or some vegetables, some carrots, and all of a sudden... Sandwiches are good too, and sometimes I'll have a donut, and that's always a good thing to have. Yeah, donuts are good. And that makes me smile. That makes me happy. That gives me a happy face.
I have donuts at my house.
You do have donuts at your house? Does that give you a happy face? Show me a happy face. Do you have a happy face? Ah, yeah, big old grin. Oh, that's a good one. Do y'all have happy faces? No happy faces there. Oh, that's a happy face. Oh, yeah, you get a happy face. I get a happy face. And today in our Bible story, we're going to hear about how Jesus, in our Jesus story, he is over here. And this kid has got two fish and five
loaves of bread.
That's right, five loaves of bread. And Andrew goes, it's not a lot. But we can see what happens, and Jesus takes that two fish, and he takes those five loaves, and it looks a little like this. I meant to get this up for you. Sorry. I want to show you what that looks like. It looks a little like this. Does that look like a lot of food to you?
No,
not for 5,000 people. That doesn't look like a lot of food. But Jesus takes that, and the Bible says he feeds everyone. That's all your fingers and two of your toes. That's all your fingers and two of your toes filled with leftovers from this little bit. So what we know is when we give a little to God, no matter how much we have, when we give it to God, God can use it and God can bless and care for others with it. So if you have a toy and you're playing with your friends and you only got one toy, what should you do?
Share.
You should share, Del. That's right. And then everybody gets to play. And so everybody is cared for by sharing what you have. All right, you guys have been so good. Thank you for coming up. Let me say a prayer. Let's put our hands together and let's bow our heads. And let's say,
Dear God,
thank you for what you've given us.
Help us
to share it with others.
Amen.
Thank you guys, y'all have been so good. Thank you for coming up. You can follow Mr. Billy and Mr. Jerry over there and go to children's time, or you can go back to be with your parents. It's up to you.
Comes from John's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 1 through 15. Please listen for a word from the Lord. After this, Jesus went across the Galilee Sea, that is, the Tiberias Sea. A large crowd followed him because they had seen the miraculous signs he had done among the sick. Jesus went up a mountain and sat there with his disciples. It was nearly time for Passover, the Jewish festival. Jesus looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him. He asked Philip, "Where will we buy food to feed these people?" Jesus said this to test him, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "More than a half year's salary worth of food wouldn't be enough for each person to have even a little bit." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said, "A youth here has five barley loaves and two fish. But what good is that for a crowd like this?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass there. They sat down, about 5,000 of them. Then Jesus took the bread. When he had given thanks, he distributed it to those who were sitting there. He did the same with the fish, each getting as much as they wanted. When they had plenty to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the leftover pieces, so that nothing will be wasted. So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves that had been left over by those who had eaten. When the people saw that he had done a miraculous sign, they said, "This is truly the prophet who is coming into the world." Jesus understood that they were about to come and force him to be their king, so he took refuge again, alone on a mountain. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
May I invite you to pray with me? Almighty God, so draw our hearts to you, so guide our minds, so fill our imaginations, so control our wills, that we may be wholly yours, utterly dedicated to you. And by your Spirit, use us as you will, always to your glory and the welfare of all your people, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. A little over 100 years ago, a young girl named Agnes felt a nudge from God to go into ministry. She had heard about the lives of missionaries, and she was fascinated by their stories and adventures in far-off countries. And by the age of 12, she was confident that God was calling her to help the poor. In fact, Agnes and her mother would host the poorest members of their community at their family dinners. Reminiscing about those times, Agnes would share how her mother believed that they never should eat dinner unless they were sharing the meal with others. "They may not be our relations," her mother would say, "but all of them are our people." That memory stayed with Agnes as she got older. So when she turned 18, she followed God's call with enthusiasm, confident that she was being summoned to do important work that would change the world. And in 1928, she went to Ireland to study to be trained as a missionary. And soon after, Agnes was sent to Darjeeling, India, in northern India, where she taught school. And it was just a matter of weeks, it was obvious that she had a natural gift for education. She was so good, in fact, that she was promoted by the bishop and sent to eastern India to teach school there. And eventually, she was promoted even again to be headmistress of the whole school. Her childhood dreams had come true. She was living the adventure and being a missionary in a foreign land. She had meaning, she had purpose, she had security. Perhaps it was those things that troubled her. You see, she had to commute every day to school and was bombarded with scenes of poverty and food insecurity as she went through the slums of eastern India. A severe famine in her region had left thousands starving and malnourished. The feeling, it convicted Agnes, and she needed to do something, even if it was the wrong thing. She needed to do anything. So she left her position as headmistress and focused on ministering directly to the poor. While her ministry before had been an instant success, ministry in the slums, well, that proved to be more of a challenge. During those first days, she started a school in the slums with only 5 students, but she wasn't able to recruit any more than that, and eventually the students had to be dispersed, sent off to other schools. Agnes then tried medicine. She took some courses, got some training in the hopes of providing medical care to those in the slums, but soon found herself just overwhelmed. She just didn't know enough about medicine, and her confidence began to just whittle away. To make matters worse, She had invested a great deal of her own finances into each of these tasks, but because she had lost her income from teaching, her personal funds, it slowly depleted down to almost nothing at all. 20 years after she had left her home, she found herself almost completely broke and begging for food and supplies from her friends and from her former colleagues. Like any of us in that situation, Agnes began to question her sense of call. She wrote in her diary about the doubts and the temptation she felt to give it all up, to return back to teaching at the school. After all, she had a clear sense of purpose there. It was a safe place there. She felt like she was at home there. Her dream of helping the poor by living amongst them had left her feeling that what she had to give was never going to be enough. She felt like all she had sacrificed was for nothing. She felt like she had let down her order. She felt like she had let down the people she wanted to serve, the vulnerable, the children. After all, what is the point of all the effort if you can't meet the need? What good were the small amounts of food? What good was the amateur medicine? What good was the basic education among a whole city overrun with hunger and famine and disease? You know, I wonder if that's how Philip felt when Jesus asked him the question from our passage today. Because the answer he gave has this sense of hopelessness about it. More than half a year's salary worth of food? It wouldn't be enough for each person to have even a little bit. I mean, you see, Philip realized that they are about to have a lot of hangry people on their hands. It's right about then that Andrew shows up and he mentions, well, there's this boy. He has 5 loaves, 2 fish, which moves the solution to the topic at hand from going out and purchasing to collecting and sharing. But even Andrew looks at this small collection and says, but what good is that for in a crowd like this? Or as we would to say, what difference is that going to make? Don't we still ask that question? I mean, when we look at issues in the community and around the world, food insecurity, clean drinking water, affordable housing, early childhood development, basic vaccinations that just cost pennies, but for third world countries, the refugee crisis. We are all too aware of the basic human needs that stretch from the concrete median of Woodlawn and Park Road all the way to remote villages in Africa. After all, that's part of our motivation for investing in faith communities, isn't it? Because we know that the church works hard to make an impact in Charlotte. That's why we give to loaves and fishes. It makes an impact to help the hungry here in Charlotte and around the world. Our younger folks, they just went to West Virginia this summer to work in a halfway house for the folks in transition. What a gift they gave to that community. I mean, it was blazing hot, and they're getting dehydrated, climbing up on ladders, trying to repair and fix a house so that 8 to 18 folks who are going through a transition can have a safe place to live. What a gift you gave by following through with your pledge, by purchasing Christmas greenery at the Christmas market, by participating in other fundraisers so that they can go to be our missionaries, to be our disciples in a hurt and broken world. What a gift you gave. You know, when I served in Moore County, we used to do these church builds, and I loved it. I mean, the camaraderie of working with other church members from other churches. I loved the learning of new home improvement skills. Carrie doesn't let me use them very much, and she's smart that way, but I loved learning them all the same. I loved getting to work alongside and getting to interact with folks who were going to live in the homes that we ourselves were building. But there was always a part of me that would wonder about the housing that was needed for the other 300 homeless folks in Moore County. I took basic accounting in college, took it 3 times, in fact, and I learned I didn't want to be a CPA. I also learned that the math has got to balance out. Your debits better equal your credits. Your numbers, they have to add up. There's this great story in the Old Testament about the prophet Elijah, who is in a group of people in a land that is plagued by famine, just like our friend Agnes. And the men, they're all hungry. They're hangry, in fact. And another man from another village, he brings Elijah 20 loaves of bread. And Elijah says this. He says, "Give it to the people so they can eat." And the man said, How can I feed 100 men with this?" Elijah said, "Well, give it to the people so they can eat. This is what the Lord says. Eat. There'll be leftovers." So the servant gave the food to them. They ate and had leftovers in agreement with the Lord's word. That's what it says in the Bible. You see, Elijah, he knows that the math, it doesn't balance out. He knows that the numbers, they don't add up. But you see, Elijah trusts in God's word. And he sends the man to give what he can and trusts that through the work of God, it'll be enough. It's going to be enough. Have you ever heard the story of Millard and Linda Fuller? They were a couple that lived in the deep south in Georgia and in Alabama back in the 1960s. And while living there, they became concerned about the supply of low-cost housing in those areas. Millard was a successful businessman, you see, and he decided to put all his energy and all his time into figuring out a solution. The two came up with this model of using volunteer labor to help build homes. You see, the biggest cost of building homes is the material, but the next biggest cost is the labor that's included. And at first, they could just do a few houses a year, but eventually, the idea began to take hold, and soon, they became known as Habitat for Humanity, which has helped over 59 million people globally attain homes to build security for themselves, for their families, their loved ones. It started with just a few homes in a country that needed thousands of them, but God took what was given, the desire, the energy of Mildred and Linda, and went broader, went further than they ever thought possible. Oh, you're right. When that little boy came up to the disciples with just 5 loaves and just 2 fish, there was no way that they would feed 5,000 folks. And yet God's love, God's grace, fed everyone till they were satisfied. You see, through Christ, we can give ourselves faithfully without feeling a sense of doubt creeping in to all of our efforts, making us feel like it's all vain. After that first year of living in the slums, Agnes continued to wrestle with her sense of call, her mission. She still felt this desire to serve, but she just couldn't see the results. The math, it just didn't add up, but she continued to bring it to God anyway. And then one day, she got a call from the Vatican. They had been watching her work and her passion to care for those that had no one to care for them, and it inspired the leaders of the Catholic Church to work along beside her. So they gave her a grant to help her start a congregation with only 13 members. This faithful work started to attract the attention of others. Soon, these sisters and the work they were doing of caring for those in hospice and helping to feed and strengthen the malnourished children, well, that got national attention. It got global recognition. Soon, the world knew who Agnes was. They called her Mother Teresa. By 1963, the missionaries of charity had grown rapidly. They were given endorsement. They were given encouragement to open other communities and other places. I got to visit one of them when I went to Haiti a number of years ago. In 2023, they had 5,750 members serving at 139 countries and 760 missionaries of charity homes, the congregations that Agnes started. Agnes's faith and trust in God and her ministry to the poor, it grew and grew from such a meager offering to an abundance of what it is today. I don't believe she ever expected this. Agnes was only doing what the boy in our passage had done, giving food that he had, praying to God that it would be something more. Agnes was doing what the Fullers were doing, creating something for people they had never met, praying for a better life for them. Agnes was doing only what Elijah had done, offering what he had, trusting in God that it would be enough. There'd be enough. So my friends, my hope is that when you feel like your ministry, the ministry you're doing is not enough, when you think that all your sacrifice and all your energy won't change things that are beyond your control, when you wonder, what difference is this going to make? May you remember a little boy. A boy that gave what little he had. And by God's love, by God's grace, fed 5,000. It was enough. With God, it's always enough. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit, amen. I invite you to join me as we rise in body or spirit and offer our song of response for the fruit of all creation. You to remain standing as we affirm what it is that we believe, offering together the affirmation of faith you find before you. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture. It engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy, joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus." Believers, in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. As we turn to God, we are mindful of those who have shared their prayers with us on the prayer wall just over there. They have asked us to continue to pray for the Thompson family. They've asked us to pray for the Carr family. They ask for prayers for Lily, who will have her last cleft palate surgery on Wednesday. The Allman family has asked for our prayers. Little Alex, as you know, has been recovering from cancer and is due for another set of PET scans this month. And so they ask for our prayers as we continue to walk with him through this journey. We've been asked to pray for Don Cates. Let us keep these and those that are deep within our hearts in our prayers as we unite our hearts before God in prayer. Let us pray. O God of peace, as we hear and read of conflict in the world, we pray to send us your healing and reconciling power, so that fear may be cast out by love, weapons replaced by trust, and violence give way to understanding. O God of justice, make real your mercy and your righteous judgment, so that we may hear the cries of the oppressed, that we may see the suffering of the poor in our own neighborhoods, and return to your way, a way of righteousness, a way of compassion. O God of love, help us recognize your extravagant goodness and blessings, that we may see you in the people of every race and culture. Embrace you in the lonely, in the bereaved, in the rejected, and be an accepting and caring church. O God of unity, permeate us with your forgiveness and your healing grace so that we may witness to reconciliation for a divided world, gathered around Christ's table as one people, and to turn the other cheek to those who harm us. O God of hope and promises, we marvel at your faithfulness for all generations, even when we have not been faithful to you. We ask that your mysterious, your powerful presence, that it would be made known to people who are in special need this day, and help all of us, all of humanity, celebrate the new things you are doing in this world as we journey toward your kingdom coming here on earth. Hear us, we humbly pray, as we offer together what Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
You know, all the rules and the laws of our faith are summed up by the law of love for God and the love of one another. Everything, it hangs on that, the law of love. We don't just talk about it here at Avondale. We bring it to life in our ministry and where we offer hospitality. We build community. We act with compassion and we do justice work. And in all those things, we worship and we love God and we offer our love to our neighbor. That is what this ministry and our gifts are all about. And all that hangs on the gift of love. So let us gather our gifts together and let us offer them to God in gratitude and in praise. Let us bring forth our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. In the spirit of faith, holy God, we thank you for the opportunity to give tithes and offerings, to participate in extending your grace to more and more people, and to give all glory to you. Amen. I invite you to join me as we rise in body or spirit and offer our closing hymn, Let us talents and tongues employ. Thank you. Oh, as you go, remember that you are loved, that God calls you by name and will never, ever let you go. May that love encourage you. May it inspire you to share all the gifts that God has given you, no matter how small they may be. For our God can do big things with all that is given. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's countenance shine upon you and grant you peace now and forevermore in a world that truly has no end. Amen. Go in peace.
I just did a little.
I like that.
Yes, sir. I like it right there.